Them, please.
I wanted to tell a story of a Shkocha Protus that happened to me tonight. Tonight is, what's the date tonight? Chof Hei, Chof Vov.
Chof Vov.
Siv Er Tishre, Tov Shinayin Tes. We have a chasna in the family. My sister made a chasna, her son, Baruch Hashem.
Which sister is this?
My sister, her name is Fagi Savitsky.
Ah, Fagi. Okay, continue.
And she, her son got married, Baruch Hashem. It was a big simcha. Now, I went by bus by myself. Although I have maybe a sister that has a car, two sisters have a car, but it didn't work out. I couldn't get a ride, and I went by bus. Now, I came to the bus, stop in the place that's called Knisalayir, which is near Givat Shaul. There's a lot of buses there. They go to places, Chutzliyah. And I stood there and I looked on the signs of the bus stop. Where does it say bus stop in Nebrak? And I finally found it. So it said there, buses to Nebrak 400, 401, and 403. I didn't understand. Why doesn't it say 402? I know that the 402 goes to Bnei Brak. So, I don't know.
I'll tell you. Oh, you're going to tell. I could tell you why.
Why didn't it say it was?
Because it doesn't go that way. It goes through remote, the Kavishan remote.
It doesn't go over there.
Yeah. It goes to
Kardesh
Katz,
where
my son and I used to live.
So I took the first one that came, which was the 400, the year. It was the 400. Now, that was a mistake. But I didn't know that at the time that's a mistake. And you'll soon hear why. It said on it the Bnei Brak, so I got on it. When he gets close, when he gets to Bnei Brak, see, he doesn't go in through the regular way. The regular way, everybody knows, it goes by the Coca-Cola. That's what it's called. You know, you go by the factory of Coca-Cola. They say it goes by the Coca-Cola. And that's, everybody knows that. And this one didn't go by the... And then I saw him, he went in through Rehov Jabotinsky. That much I do know. That's all the way in the end of Rehov Rabbi Akiva, the name. Just happens to be that recently I read a book about Zionism, and I read a little bit about who Jabotinsky was, and it gave me a slight shudder I felt when what we're going into Rehov Jabotinsky, what a Russia. I felt that feeling. Of course, when you live in the place, you don't even think about it. Just like when we live in Yerushalayim, we don't think about Shedrut Herzl, that it has something to do with Herzl. We don't think. We just know that that's a big road to Beit Vigan. But okay, so they went in from Jabotinsky. This much I understood. I knew that that's the other end of Bnei Brak. So what am I going to do now? And my nerves started shaking because I'm not so good at finding my way around. And I'm not so good at going up to people and asking for directions. And my daughter once told me, my daughter Tila Bracha once, I told her this, so she said, "But you're a grown man." So I said, "Yeah, but in some things you stay a baby. What can I do?" So anyway, my nerves started shaking. I started getting all tense. And I asked the driver, it took courage to go up and ask the driver. Do I get off? I need Rechav Shlomo HaMelech, the Heichlei Malchus is the hall. So he says, oh, that's the other end. I don't know what to tell you. I think you should get off on the corner of Rabbi Akiva and Chazanish. So, okay, I got off there. Now, what do I do now? So I went up to ask somebody. So he said, you better go in Rechav Chazanish, and his bus is there, and this. So I went in Rechav Chazanish. And then I didn't know what do I do now? So,
Rabbi Kaplan.
What?
You never heard about taking a taxi once in a while?
Oh, very good. That's what I was thinking. I heard of it. I heard of it. So I started looking for a taxi. I tried to stop one, tried to stop another one. And it looks like in Bnei Brak there are not that many taxis. That's what it looks like. And they didn't stop for me. So Hashem helped, and I went up to a person that he's probably the same age as me, which is 65. And I asked him, how do you get the Ulam Echlein Malchus in Rechav Shlomo HaMelech? So he's holding a petek in his hand, and he says, oh, that's where I'm going. And I see in the petek, it says, Heichal HaPeher Rechav Shlomo HaMelech. A little bit strange to me, if he's a Bnei Braker, so what does he have to have a petek in his hand for, to tell him where to go? Okay, I don't know. So it comes out the person is a Bnei Braker, and he's going to the same place I'm going. It could be the name change, Heichal Peher, Heichal Malchus, or maybe there's upstairs and downstairs, but it came out that he's going to the same place. So he says, okay, I'm going there, so let's walk together. It's not kedai for you to wait for a bus. It could take longer. For waiting for a bus could take longer than walking. So you could see a lot of people in that valley gone over there, and buses and people. So I said, oh, we'll walk together. Okay, we'll walk together. Now, usually, somebody would say, I'll walk together. I'd start getting nervous because what am I going to do when I walk with him? Am I going to talk to him or am I going to not talk to him? And if I talk to him, what am I going to talk about? And if I talk, I might make a fool of myself. I might start saying things that he doesn't care about. And who knows what mistakes you can make if you start going walking with somebody you don't know. You start walking with a stranger. So, of course, it was a from a yid.
Rabbi Kaplan.
What?
He was going to the same wedding or just...
No, there's... four halls in the same building, or maybe even five. There's five chasnas could be going on at once. If you remember, Yosef's chasna was in that same building, and in the middle of his chuppah, you heard music from upstairs, real loud, in the middle of his chuppah from a different chasna. So he's going to one chasna, I'm going to another one, but the same building. So walking, so once we're walking, I said, oh, I better be chofer. You know what chofer means? So chofer means to start digging into the other person and ask him, who are you, what are you, where do you come from? Now, you see it in Maftar Yonah, where we just landed on Yom Kippur. Ma malachtcha ma'in tovo ma'atzecha ve'mizeh omoto. What they asked Yonah. So I said, okay, I'll ask him. So I asked him, what's your name? He tells me, his name is Kusovsky. And there was a rov in South Africa, Menachem Kusovsky or something. Somebody that he was Rab Chaim Ozer's brother-in-law. Rab Chaim Ozer convinced him to travel to South Africa and become a rov there. Could they be mechazik to Yiddishkeit? And this person is a great-grandson of the brother of this Rav Kusovsky, Menachem Kusovsky. I keep forgetting what the name was. Doesn't matter. So, now, He's talking about this Ralph Krushovsky. They went to South Africa and he wrote letters. And he wrote letters to Chaim Moser, and Chaim Moser wrote to him. And this person says he put out 3 volumes of the letters of Reb Chaim Moser, a lot to his great uncle and to others. Okay, then as he's talking, and I still didn't tell my name, so I felt proud of myself. I'm, instead of being a blabbermouth like I am many times, I'm first I'm getting the other person to tell his story before I tell my story. So he was happy, it seems. But the MS is that it's a devil. People, most people, they like to talk about themselves. But he didn't look like that type. That's some people like that's their whole life. Like all you do have to do is press a button and talk about yourself, as is, so to speak. And they'll just start going, they don't care what, if you're listening, you're not listening, you care, you don't care. As long as you're there, your body is there. And they, more than that, they don't know. Are you really listening? Do you really care? You can tell. You can tell many times if the person really cares or not. So, but they don't understand that, these people. So, but this was, it didn't look like that kind of a person. Anyway, so he's telling and telling. And then he tells me like this, that his father was Rab Shaul Krushovsky. And he wrote as soon as he said that, and he said that they recently put out his letters in a sefer. They put out his letters. Now, and right away when he said that, I already understood who it was, that this Reb Shaul Krushovsky was a very strong Ben Torah. He knew the Chad Shaychus to the Chad Zinish, and later to Reb Chaim Graneman. And he got sick with leukemia, and he died probably 15 years ago, around 50 years ago. Now, this person I was talking to was a son of that person, of Reb Shaul Krushovsky. And he tells me that he was 11 years old when his father died. And Reb Chaim Graneman took care. He called him the apotropos on the family. Because this Reb Shaul Krushovsky, the father that died, was very close with Reb Chaim Graneman. Reb Chaim Graneman took him on himself, apotropsis on the family, to take care of the children, to raise the Yisamim. And he said he married him off. He said on himself, Uchitenuti, he married me off. Now, it's like this. Now listen to this. I remember in the year, what year was it? I think it was 66. It was around then. Now, we came to Eretz Yisrael in 62. And we lived in Makor Baruch near Gula 3 years. That's 65. And we moved to Beit Vigan. Now, this was Mamish in the year 66. It was still the beginning of our living in Beit Vigan. Now, in those days, the Beit Vigan was very small. And what, there wasn't any shuls. There was only Rabbi, they made a minyan for Rabbi Abramsky. And
where was his house?
What?
Where, on Rehov Breuer there?
Chido. And the school was, Rav Lechter's school was on Rehov Chido.
Oh.
And later on, they built him a building and they moved to where he is now, but it was on Rehov Chido. There was a school there, I think it was the boys' school. He also, but there was a girls' school. I don't remember which one this was, but... And they had a minion there. Those were the Yekis that Rabbi Abramsky davened with. And later they became the Gro in Beit Vigan many
I got Rabbi Kaplan. We're taking a break. Thank you.